Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel, MD, general physician. All my video lectures are for educative purpose. Today we are going to start with clinical examination of alimentary system. It will be divided into 5 parts. Today we'll be talking on introductory part, little introduction to what is examination of abdomen. Ideally we should say examination of abdomen rather than alimentary system, because in abdomen there are other structures also. We examine as an abdominal examination. So it is abdominal examination, and this is an introductory part. You can see here the person is having a contractures. This is called deputrine contractures, which is one of the characteristic finding in case of cirrhosis of liver. This is redness in the palm. This is called palmar erythema. This is jaundice. You can see here there is a distension of abdomen with umbilical hernia. This is ascites with umbilical hernia. So a good inspection gives you a lot of idea regarding a disease part of it. So we'll be covering up those in separate parts. Today we'll be talking on introduction. So history and physical examination. It is said that 70% of the diagnosis can be made just by the history alone. 90% of the diagnosis can be made by history and physical examination. Expensive test often confirms what is found during history and physical examination. So just by doing a good history and good physical examination, you can come to the most closest to the differential diagnosis. Hence, it is said that history and physical examination is the best way of coming to the nearmost diagnosis. So always introduce yourself whenever you want to take a history and you want to do a physical examination. Ideally, we should take a written consent of a patient that he is allowing you to examine him. A good history, that is, what are the symptoms for which he has approached you, and regarding the symptoms, how it started, what is the duration, how it has progressed, in detail should be taken. In addition to that, we already mentioned all this particular part in history taking and general examination, that is family history, past history pertaining to a present complaint, personal history, or we call social history, and drugs, if he is on any particular drugs. Then we go for vital data examination. We have already done all the different chapters on vital data, that is pulse, blood pressure, temperature, respiration. Now it also includes level of consciousness, skin examination, pupillary examination, even urine input output chart, etc. Even pulse oximeter is also included. And then we go to the physical examination, that is general examination, which is a part of physical examination. I have already uploaded the video on general examination. Please go through that. Then we start with a specific system, that is abdominal examination, where we do inspection first, and it should be followed by auscultation before we do palpation and percussion, so that you can pick up any disturbances regarding the bowel sounds. Then you go for palpation and percussion. Normally we always do inspection, palpation, percussion, and auscultation is done last as far as respiratory system is concerned and cardiovascular system is concerned. But in abdominal examination, inspection is followed by auscultation, then followed by palpation and percussion. PR proctoscopy, and in female, PR proctoscopy plus per speculum and per vaginal examination should be done. It is a part of abdominal examination. External genital examination, inguinal region, groin, back. Look for hernia and hernial orifices. And examination of perianal region is a part of abdominal examination. While doing all this examination, you should maintain the patient dignity. In which person you will be doing an abdominal examination? That is, any person who comes with a pain in abdominal region, person who has got jaundice, loss of appetite, dysphagia, persistent nausea, vomiting, hematemesis, or person comes to you with malina or bleeding per rectum, or it is also called as a hematochezia, loose motion, dysentery, steatorrhea, distension of abdomen, urinary complaint like anuria, oliguria, hematuria, retention of urine, dysuria, there are many more. We call lower urinary tract symptoms. In female, dysmenorrhea, metromenorrhagia, leukorrhea, or if someone comes with swelling or lump in abdomen, or vomiting, constipation, or alternate vomiting with constipation. You can divide those symptoms into few groups like upper GI tract, lower GI tract, others. So this will be pertaining to GI tract. Some of the cardinal symptoms like heartburn, dyspepsia, dysphagia, non-cardiac chest pain, nausea, diarrhea, constipation, abdominal pain, weight loss, hematemesis, malina, etc. Some of the upper GI tract symptoms like dysphagia, odynophagia, reflux symptoms like heartburn, chest burn, regurgitation. This will be some of the symptoms. Lower GI tract symptoms like visceral pain, parietal pain, pain because of acute cholecystitis, a well-localized pain in epigastric region, different quadrants, diffuse abdominal pain, pain in a lower abdomen or in the pelvic region, pain related to meal or related to defecation. This will be more in favor of lower GI tract symptoms. Abnormality in the stool, that is increased frequency or decreased frequency like constipation. Large volume, sticky, false smelling like steatorrhea, or change in the stool consistency, change in the color, a black color stool like malina, or red color like bleeding per rectum or hematochezia, constipation, where you can go for frequency, consistency, colonic dysfunction, how frequently he goes for a stool. So all this you can get in a history. Then hematochezia means bleeding per rectum, which can be fresh red or purple brown or small driblets or diffuse. Depending upon that, you can suspect some of the conditions. Each we'll be discussing in a separate symptomatology, because I will not be covering the symptomatology of alimentary system. Some other time we'll be covering those particular part. Regarding diarrhea, you can get a good history. Then steatorrhea, that is presence of excess of fat in the stool, which is very commonly seen. So we person will always complain of a bulky stool, sticky stool, false smelling stool. It is characteristic, very frequently seen in a chronic pancreatitis, celiac disease, cholestasis, giardiasis, Crohn's disease, etc. In all these diseases, you can get steatorrhea. Occasionally, person can present to you with a fecal incontinence, that is involuntary defecation, where it is very frequently due to diabetes mellitus, rectoanal tumors, fecal impaction, accidental injury to rectal or anus, or injury to what we call as anal sphincter. You can have symptoms secondary to prolapse or because of the prolapse piles like pruritus, pain, tenesmus, heart defecations, etc. Now, little idea regarding if a person comes with the upper GI tract symptoms, you will usually go for endoscopy. If you are suspecting GERD, you can go for manometry, barium swallow. And following an upper GI endoscopy, if you are suspecting Barrett's esophagus or malignancy, you can go for biopsy. If clinically history and from examination you are suspecting a pathophysiologic concern with stomach, you can go for upper GI endoscopy including esophagus and stomach. You can ask for barium meal, and during endoscopy in suspected duodenal ulcer or suspected gastric ulcer or gastric carcinoma, you can go for biopsy. In case of suspected duodenal pathology like DU, you can go for endoscopy. In case of malignancy of ampulla of water, you can go for ERCP biopsy. In pancreatic pathology, suspected pancreatic pathology, you can go for ERCP. Even in an obstructive jaundice, ERCP will be very helpful. In a suspected pathophysiology of a small intestine, there is something called as an advanced endoscopy, or you can go for a capsule endoscopy, barium meal, barium follow through, double balloon endoscopy, etc. In a large bowel, by and large, you go for colonoscopy, or it is called coloscopy, PR proctoscopy, sigmoidoscopy, and along with that, you can go for biopsy. Barium enema may be indicated in some of the conditions. These are some of the introductory part of what investigation will be useful in which suspected pathophysiology. If you are suspecting a liver pathology, a person has come to you with a jaundice, etc., you will be asking for bilirubin, direct, indirect, SGPT, SGOT, or we call ALT, AST, alkaline phosphatase, prothrombin time, prothrombin index, or INR, serum protein, that is total protein, albumin, globulin ratio, etc. And then if required, you can go for liver biopsy. Ultrasound is a must, and it is a non-invasive technique which gives you a good idea regarding a liver anatomy. In suspected gallbladder and biliary tract disorders, you can go for cholangiography. In gallbladder pathology, you can go for cholangiography, ultrasound, and ERCP study. In pancreatic pathophysiology, you can ask for amylase, lipase, calcium, then blood sugar level, ultrasound, ERCP, and sometimes CT scan or MRI scan. As such, CT abdomen or MRI abdomen will be asked for when you do not come to the nearmost diagnosis. That will be one of the important investigation. If you are suspecting renal involvement, that is kidney involvement, blood urea, creatinine, total protein, urine examination or urinary analysis, in recurrent stones, particularly radiopaque stones, calcium stones, you can go for calcium, phosphate, parathormon level, uric acid level in a suspected uric acid stones, then sodium, potassium, pH, hemoglobin. These are usually asked in person who has got AKI or CKD. Among the radiological investigation, KUB is one of the earliest investigation, but almost sonography, a good sonography has replaced KUB. Almost intravenous urography is the another by using the radiopaque dye. CT or MRI is rarely required in a person who has got a renal disorders. In some of the condition, you can go for cystoscopy, particularly which is very important in case of a bladder pathology. Ultrasound is a very simple non-invasive technique which can give you a very good idea regarding a bladder as well as kidney, bladder, kidney and ureter. Along with cystoscopy, you can go for biopsy in a suspected patient with a bladder papilloma or bladder carcinoma. In a neurogenic bladder, you can go for a pressure studies, cystography, etc. And when there you are suspecting regurgitation in ureter, you can go for a retrograde urography. In a urethral pathophysiology, we usually use the word micturition urethrography, and you can go for urethroscopy. In a case of a prostate examination, PR is very, very important. Ultrasound gives you a good idea. A cystoscopy will also help you out. And while getting a cystoscopy done, you can go for a biopsy. And PSA, that is prostatic specific antigen, which is very, very important for in a suspected person with a prostatic malignancy. These are some of the investigations which we are mentioning. And depending upon the clinical and then laboratory parameters or investigative parameters, you can go for further investigations. In a spleen pathology, you can go for ultrasound, biopsy, CBC. In India, malaria and kalazar is quite common. If person comes with a rectal pathophysiology, PR, proctoscopy and biopsy. In any pathophysiology of external genital, a very good external examination with ultrasound followed by a biopsy may be very, very helpful. Already we mentioned that normal sequence is inspection, palpation, percussion and auscultation. While in case of an abdominal examination, it is inspection followed by auscultation, followed by percussion, followed by palpation. Usually we follow this pattern. Some person follows inspection, auscultation, followed by palpation and then percussion. It is usually followed by PR proctoscopy in both sex, that is male and female. In female, additionally PSPV examination, that is per speculum, per vaginal examination. Hernial orifices and external genital examination is a part of abdominal examination. We have already mentioned that auscultation should be done before a palpation or percussion of abdominal examination to prevent an impact of palpation which can give you or alter the bowel sounds. So before the bowel sounds gets altered, auscultation should be done and then it should be followed by palpation and percussion. So always try to follow that particular pattern. In a case of abdominal examination, a good general examination related to abdominal viscera like liver, kidney, gallbladder, etc. should be done properly. So always before the abdominal examination, upper part of the patient body should be examined, remove the clothes, outpatient room should be warm, always examine, that is inspection, palpation, percussion and auscultation should be done by standing on the right side of the patient. Always wear white coat, light shorts will be there, measurements, pencil, notebook to mention the findings. There should be enough daylight. Hands should be warm and clean. All these precautions should be taken while doing a general physical examination, while examining the abdomen. As far as physical examination related to abdomen, look for cachexia, dehydration, orientation. Because person can have a disoriented if a person is having hepatic coma or uremia. Starting from head till toe, conjunctiva, look for pallor, look for jaundice. Close to the upper eyelid, xanthalasma. At the cornea, KF ring, we call Kescher fascia ring. Temporal muscle wasting, rhinophyma. In upper extremity, look for clubbing, look for white nails, which can be common in liver disorders, palmar erythema, dipuytren contractures. twisting of the muscles, spider nevi close to the clavicle, pyoderma gangrenosum. These are some of the findings which you can look for. KF ring is quite commonly seen in what we call as classical in case of a Wilson disease, which is a golden yellow ring. This is a typical prayer sign. You can see that there is a deformity which is a very classical. This is called prayer sign. You can see pigmentation secondary due to hemochromatosis. This is severe cachexia. You can see jaundice. Difference between these two, you can see the little yellowish discoloration. So jaundice, pigmentation, mental status, pallor, severe wasting, you can easily. This is, you can see a person is emaciated. So cachexia is there. There is jaundice. These are spider nevi. This is deputrine contractures. This is palmar erythema. Some of these findings gives you a very good idea. These are all the three findings together of chronic liver disease, particularly cirrhosis of liver. And this is most probably obstructive jaundice. And because there is a severe emaciation, it could be secondary due to malignancy. You can see clear-cut yellow color sclera. This is palmar erythema, spider nevi. You can see severe pallor. You can compare with your own palm. You can easily identify this. Some of this condition may give you a clue towards the diagnosis. This is clubbing. Clubbing is a very common feature in malignancy. This is deputrine contracture. This is coilonychia, very characteristic in iron deficiency anemia. You can get a white brittle nail in case of chronic liver disease. These are flaps, which is very characteristic of hepatic flaps, that is in hepatic pre-coma and coma. So clubbing, coilonychia, leukonychia, this is also called as a leukonychia. Then you can have a palmar erythema. These are all the different features which can go. This is classical xanthalasma. This is cachexia. This is pigmented lips. This is jaundice. This is classical KF ring. This is spider nevi. This is a nasal pathology. This is again a spider nevi. So in hepatitis or chronic liver disease, jaundice, fatigue, weight loss, loss of appetite, history of jaundice, abdominal distension, altered level of consciousness, flaps, etc. can be easily seen. These are classical asterixes, which you can see in liver as well as what we call as in renal failure, or we call uremia. Even in COPD also, you can have a flaps. So do remember that. They are also called as flaps or flapping tremors or asterixes. Flapping tremor can be seen in large number of conditions. These are all the different conditions you can see of flapping tremors. But classical these three, always remember hepatic encephalopathy, uremia, and severe COPD. Severe COPD, or we can call that as carbon dioxide narcosis. Clubbing, very classical in Crohn's disease or IBD, cirrhosis of liver, lymphomas, malabsorption syndromes like celiac disease, among respiratory condition, lung malignancy, empyema, cystic fibrosis, bronchiectasis, mesothelioma, bronchogenic carcinoma, and in cardiac, congenital cyanotic heart disease, infective endocarditis, atrial myxoma. These are some of the conditions. These are the figures showing you some of the findings. This is angular stomatitis. This is arcus sinalis. This you can see again, angular involvement. This is pigmentation, xanthalasma, jaundice. This is telangiectasia. This is again a dark jaundice, more in favor of an obstructive jaundice, pallor, KF ring, glossitis, a big parotid tumor, more likely to be malignancy. You can see a subcutaneous bleeding around the umbilicus we call as a Kulen sign. This is bleeding in a other area, that is the lower part of abdomen, we call as a Gray Turner sign. This is glossitis in case of vitamin deficiency. Also, you can get in iron deficiency anemia, pernicious anemia, etc. This is angular involvement, that is angular stomatitis, which you can get in a post-infection, celiac disease, Crohn's disease, Plumber-Vinson, that is iron deficiency anemia also. Aphthous ulcer can be because of GI tract problems, secondary to antibiotics, even inflammatory bowel disease. Jaundice will be very frequently. Three classical groups we put: hemolytic, hepatic, and obstructive jaundice. Pallor, you can easily identify pallor. Then clubbing, chorionicia, palmar erythema, dipterine contracture, spider nevi, then leukonychia. These are all classical stigmata of a chronic liver disease. You can see a white horizontal lines, brittle nails, chorionicia occasionally you see. Clubbing will be another common features with liver malignancy. This is dipterine contracture, clubbing, palmar erythema, and leukonychia. These are the findings you can come across. This is what we call the dilated veins around the umbilicus, we call caput medusa. This is spitting edema, gynecomastia, which is again a feature of cirrhosis of liver. Dipterine contractures. You can see classical dipterine contractures. This is Peyer's sign. Again, you can see in a chronic liver disorders. Ascites, distension of abdomen because of fluid accumulation in a peritoneal cavity. Caput medusa around the umbilicus, dilated veins. This is white nails, leukonychia, gynecomastia, loss of hair. Linea alba is very frequently following a distension of abdomen due to obesity, pregnancy, ascites, etc. And then you can see white lines, linea alba and linea niagara. Pitting edema will be a feature of hypoproteinemia or increase in extracellular fluid volume. I have already uploaded a video on approach to edema. You can see a ulceration. These are the skin changes. You can compare the two. This is pallor. This is gynecomastia. This is subcutaneous bleeding in the lower part of abdomen, that is Gray Turner sign or Turner sign, and around the umbilicus we call it a Kulen sign, which is a sign of an intra-abdominal bleeding. Then you should look at the hernial orifices like inguinal region, then umbilical region, para-umbilical region, then direct hernia, femoral hernia, lumbar hernia, and spigelian hernia. These are all the different names given to, depends upon the site. This is epigastric hernia. This is a para-umbilical hernia. This is a little bigger one. And this is a very, very large one. This is a small para-umbilical hernia. This is incisional hernia, very big incisional hernia. Now, we come to what we call as the abdominal landmarks. Before you do an inspection, palpation, percussion, and auscultation, it should be very clear in your mind regarding an abdominal fixed points, which will divide the abdomen into different quadrants. Ziphy sternum, this is a ziphoid process, or we call Ziphy sternum, and this is the pubic symphysis. If you draw the line, this is the midline, which will divide the abdomen into right and left. And if you take a mid-clavicular line and extend it further up to inguinal ligament, this is one line which is called as a lateral border of the rectus, almost. So that will divide further into middle and lateral. And if you draw the line at the level of umbilicus, it can divide this into the four quadrants. Right upper, right lower, left upper, left lower. Then we call this as a four quadrant division. So depending upon, there are some few bony landmarks. You can have a border of iliac crest. You can utilize that as a landmark. Costal margin can be utilized as a landmark. And xiphoid process, pubic symphysis. These are bony prominences which can utilize as a landmark. And then depending upon what lines you utilize, you can divide that. So when you take a midline and you take a horizontal line at the level of umbilicus, we divide into four quadrants. If you take a midclavicular line on the two sides and two horizontal lines, one at the lower border of the costal margin and one at the highest point of iliac crest, it will divide into nine quadrants. So this will be right hypochondrium, left hypochondrium, epigastrium, umbilical, right lumbar, left lumbar, right iliac fossa, hypogastrium, and left iliac fossa. Well, this will be right upper quadrant, right lower quadrant, left upper quadrant, left lower quadrant. So these are the standard landmarks which will divide into different zones. So it is very important because some of the structures are anatomically fixed in a particular area. So by history and by physical examination, you can come to the nearmost diagnosis. So division of the abdomen by examining and while taking a history is very, very important. So normally we divide by different quadrants. So there are few techniques, four quadrants, nine quadrants, seven quadrants. Four quadrant we already mentioned, midline and horizontal line at the level of umbilicus. It will divide into four quadrants. Nine quadrants means two vertical lines, which is joining the midclavicular line to the inguinal, will be dividing vertically into three, middle and two lateral, and two horizontal line, one at the lower part of the costal margin and one at the level of highest level of iliac crest, will divide into nine quadrants. Seven quadrant is usually not utilized. By and large, the most common is nine quadrants or four quadrants. As far as four quadrant, I've already mentioned right upper quadrant, left upper quadrant, right lower quadrant, left lower quadrant. This is usually utilized by a surgeon. Right upper quadrant, left upper, right lower, left lower. And these are the structures which are in right upper, left lower, and right lower. These are nine quadrants. Right hypochondrium, epigastrium, left hypochondrium, right lumbar, umbilical, right iliac, left iliac, and hypogastric region. So this is at the level of the iliac crest. This is at the lower margin of the costal margin. And these are the midclavicular line extending up to the inguinal region. So this divides into nine quadrants. And these are the structures which are present in the nine quadrants. By and large, majority of the people utilizes this nine quadrant techniques. It will depend upon the individual person, whichever he feels better. This is seven quadrant. Usually we don't utilize. This is utilized by China. They divide into two vertical lines and one horizontal line at the level of umbilicus, but which does not divide the central part. In the center, it is dividing the center into three parts. That is epigastrium, umbilical, and hypogastrium. And lateral is divided into upper and lower. So left upper, left lower, right upper, right lower, and two vertical lines at the midclavicular line will be central part. And that central part is divided further by two horizontal lines, one at the level of the lower costal margin and one at the level of the iliac crest, will divide into epigastrium, umbilical, and hypogastrium. Very odd way, but this is one of the things can be asked to you in your oral. If someone says, how you divide seven quadrants? So this will be the 4 on the 2 lateral sides and 3 in the center. So it is called 7 quadrants. Any person who comes to you with a diffuse pain all over the abdomen, always think in terms of a general peritonitis, pancreatitis, sickle cell crisis, gastroenteritis, mesenteric thrombosis, some of the metabolic disorders like decay, dissecting aneurysm or rupture aneurysm, intestinal obstruction, and don't forget psychogen. There are few conditions which can produce pain in abdomen, but on examination you may not get any abdominal finding, like acute intermittent porphyria, late colic or late toxicity, tabes dorsalis, and in psychogenic. These are the four groups you should keep it in mind. Now there are other conditions where it is a metabolic disorders like diabetic ketoacidosis, hyperthyroidism, sickle cell crisis, herpes zoster producing herpetic pain, lower lobe pneumonia, the pain may be radiated to abdomen, hypercalcemia, hyperkalemia, etc. can also produce a pain. Don't forget inferior wall myocard infarction and acute pulmonary embolism can also give rise to the pain which may be referred to abdomen. So this is an introductory part before we go for a abdominal examination like inspection, followed by auscultation, followed by palpation and percussion. It is a very, very important to get a very good history and then proceed with an examination. So I am ending a lecture on introductory part of an abdominal examination. I feel this may be helpful to you in your oral exam. Very frequently you will be asked some of these things. How you divide the abdominal quadrants, which investigation you will go for, what are the symptoms which suggest liver disorders, which are the symptoms which suggest the kidney involvement, bladder involvement, oral exams. Quite commonly these are the common things which are being asked. So I end my lecture here. I hope this will be helpful to you. If you like this lecture, please press button like, subscribe, and you can share with your friends. At the end of this lecture, I thank you all for taking out time. I know that your time is valuable and I appreciate that because you have spent some of the time with me. See you in your next lecture. We'll be having a first part of abdomen examination, that is inspection part of it.